All right, this story is going to be kind of crazy. It's going to be a good story. It's a fun story. One of the best times in my life in the hood. The title of this joint, That Spelman Girl. Woo! This is going to be good. This is going to be good. First of all, I need to give you guys some background to how such a wonderful event happened in the hood. There was this company called Urban Takeover. It was this guy that moved from New York who was running around the West End renovating houses. And he had renovated this house and rented out to some students. I remember when they were doing the construction, there was these big shiny trucks outside. There was a lot of activity. And later on, I would find out they did an amazing job. So they probably got this house for 10, 15K, probably put 20, 30K in it. And they turned it into a cash cow because essentially this was student housing. This was the way they advertised it. So that's the beginning of the story. One morning, I'm at the bus stop and I see this gorgeous girl coming down the stairs because the house was like up, there was like three landings. There was some stairs, a landing, stairs. And I'm like, woo! Because she stood out in the hood because, I mean, she was about 5'2", maybe 115, 125, fresh skin, fresh eyes, bright eyes, very, very pretty girl. So she comes over and she's coming down the steps and she's walking towards me because she's going to catch the bus. And I'm sitting there like, whoa. So she's like, hello, you know, very friendly, very light. And I'm like, how you doing? And she asked me, what's my name? I mean, I was just unusual to the formality and the pleasantries because this was the hood. Folks just normally wasn't like that. She was very open. So I got to know her name and everything. Got to talk to her. We got on the bus and she was attending Spelman. She was really young. She was 17 and a half. And I kind of got to figure this out. And we were talking and I kind of got a little rhythm. I kind of got that feeling that if I had cracked, which later on I did, that I would get in. We have this little thing because I'm down there. I'm pretty regular catching the bus because, you know, I have a gig for Labor Ready, but it's a permanent gig. This is where a gig where you don't even have to go to Labor Ready. You just go straight to the job. And I was catching the bus doing that. So I would see her every morning. We would have these little conversations. So I was just like, hey, let's hang out. She said, let's. So we started hanging out. I remember one day we were walking to the West End Mall because if you're in this neighborhood, walking is a big part of what you do because things are so close. And incidentally, I met people who live in the neighborhood who never left that neighborhood. They just were living in those streets. They never left. We go up to the West End Mall. We get some fried chicken and fried rice and momo sauce and we're having a good time. And I don't know if it happened. That was the first time we went out. Then she went home and I went home. As her roommates were coming in, because she was the first one there. And the company had rented out these rooms to other students who weren't there. She had three roommates and they were equally fresh. There was one, she was kind of stuck up attitude, but I didn't really talk to her that much. And I remember on the Saturday, I went over there to gather. We went to the West End Mall. And the West End Mall had all of these carts in the mall. And there was this one essential oil. So we bought some essential oils. Well, she bought them. More on that later. You know, just having fun. Just doing what, you know, people do on the Saturday. And we went, you know, about 8:30, we head back. And we go to her house, which, you know, is my second time in there. And I noticed just how nicely it's done. It looked like some that they would do in Buckhead or Sandy Springs. Urban Takeover did an amazing job with this house, which made it an easy sell as a rental to these parents who were paying the rent for their kids. Made it very easy. So we go in their room. Two of her roommates are there. They had just come in and introduced ourselves and stuff. Now, here's the thing about me. I didn't look my age then. I don't look my age now. I didn't really look my age then because they, you know, I looked older. They knew I wasn't a grown man, but they didn't know how old I was because I was like moved into the boarding house around 32. So this was 33-ish, 34-ish. They were like, fine, we go in the room. And her name is Lori, that Spelman chick. Lori dips in the closet and comes back butt naked.
And lays across the bed and she said, I want you to rub these oils all over my body.
At this point, I was not the man that I am today. First of all, you know, there was the standard that older men did not mess with young girls. It was this unwritten rule because no one can explain to me at, you know, at 50, are you still not going to be attracted to some young tits? No one could explain that to me. So she's like, you know, she was a track star. She had this runner's body, super tight. And instantly I was like, dick harder than Chinese arithmetic. So I take this oil and I'm massaging and I'm getting all the cheeks and crevices with this oil. And she rolls over. It was over then. I went ahead and tore that up. Because you got to understand, I was in the hood. This was after the girl with all the tattoos. And this was a more normal paced relationship. There was no hood elements, you know, and I was just in there. And part of me had, you know, was changing. Because I'm not the cat that I am today. Today, I wouldn't even thought about it. But I was sitting there like, man, she's 17 and a half. You 33, 34 years old. I paused for a second, but I got over that. You know, if you've ever had sex with a young chick, you know, they can go all night. So we just getting it. She's loud. She's saying all kinds of stuff. So I'm hitting it from the back. She's screaming. She's doing all kinds of stuff. Clearly her roommates have to hear. However, you know, we just come out and they look at us and grin and stuff. And that was about it. Going forward, Lori had to go out of town. She had to go check on her mother one weekend, and there was some housekeeping stuff they needed done. You know, I was kind of, quote, the de facto man of the house. They had me over there, so I was over when Lori was out of town. And I was in the kitchen putting up some shelves they needed. And her roommate, Denise, was very close by. She was sending out like choosing signals because she was very touchy-feely and everything. And I was like, Denise goes in her room and she calls me in there and she's like, shut the door. And she hops from behind the closet with just a towel on.
And she was just like, I want you to do to me what you do to Lori.
And at this moment, I had a constitutional crisis because I was like, I was still very much, you know, Lori was my girlfriend, and here was this other, you know, fine, young, tender, and she had these double D's that were, like, super tight. I mean, they just defied gravity, and I was just sitting there like, oh, man, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? And I was still going through this transformation. I was still looking at that value system, things that had happened, things that were not working for me, so I went ahead and hit it. And I was doing all kinds of stuff to her. And she was screaming and carrying on just like Lori. And, you know, while I was doing it, it felt good. You know, we did it, you know, all day Saturday. And I come out and the other roommates are looking all crazy. They didn't say a word. And at that moment, I realized that I had done did it. I was like, I had this perfect little situation. And how do I, you know, maintain this? So I was in my room and I was thinking, like, what are we going to do? Because, you know, it's going to get out. They're going to talk. And I just decided to confess to Lori as soon as she got back, because I met her at the airport. And I just told her. And, you know, she was a very free-spirited, almost a bohemian hippie. And she was like, yeah, she remarked that you were handsome. So, you know, we're on MARTA, heading back to the West End. And she's like, so what'd you do to her? And I get this feeling that she's not mad. She's not upset. She's more interested in what we did. So I told her and she said, really? So we go back to her room and, you know, Denise is in the common area and she waves and winks at her and we go in the room and I knock it out. So I've got this perfect situation where I am having sex with Lori and I'm having sex with Denise. Sometimes I would go see Lori, and then in the middle of the night, I would get up and go to the other room. And it was just like, how good is this? How long can this go on? So this went on for a while. And then I started to hang out with them and meet their friends. And there was this one chick, oh my God. She was from Prince George County. She was something sweet. I mean, I would have to say, in terms of being pretty, in terms of being sexy, in terms of being sophisticated, this little chick was probably the top three of all the women I ever met in my life. She had the bands because both her parents were doctors. She was going to follow in their footsteps. She's going to follow in their footsteps. And we started talking. She's very intelligent. You know, we have great conversation and stuff. And then I come to find out that she has her own apartment. She got a band. She lives by herself in Midtown. Her parents have, you know, done very nicely by her. So we're talking, and every time we meet up, we just had the best conversation. So one Saturday, she invites me over, and I go to an apartment, and she was like the new black girl that I talked about on the Man's Channel way back then. And one thing led to another, and I spent Saturday and Sunday with her. So I've got this now, this situation, because I've like, I got Lori, Denise, Prince George County, because if you know anything about Prince George County, there have been black people up there with long money for decades. I mean, they have generational wealth. And she was a very different type of chick. You know, she had bread. She was sophisticated. She just had these hobbies. So what I do is, and like confession for the soul work well, so I go back and I tell Lori what I've done. And I have this conversation with Denise. And they both like just shrugged. I mean, like, yeah, she's super pretty. That was the response. There was no jealousy. There was no animosity. There was none of that stuff. So for almost a year, this is going on. I've got the stuff with Lori. I got the stuff with Denise. And I got stuff with the princess, as I would call her. Then things started to change. Feelings started to set in. And it was the Lori. Lori started to, you know, well, first of all, I was still had my friend Lucy, who was once again upset that we weren't spending time together because I had all this young tail to handle and to situate. So I didn't really have any time with her. So every time we get together, I end up in a beef, and she like, you know,
you having sex with these young girls.
And the way that she said that, these young girls, like it was something disgusting. I was like, you're just mad because I won't have sex with you because of your extracurricular activities. And she's like, we ain't gonna even talk about that. So we ended up beefing, and I go back over to Lori's, and Lori was like, hey.
You ever had a threesome?
So we do that, her, us, and Denise. And then at one point, we bring in the princess. So it's me and these three young, sexy girls who have no baggage, who are just wide open, who are just open to anything. And I'm just sitting there like, this was one of my best memories of the hood because these were normal people. These were fun times. I remember the Red Cup parties we would have and stuff. And I look back upon those days with fond memories because during that year, my balls were never empty. I remember it would come so many times, nothing would come out. I don't know if you've ever been there. Just the generosity, just the overwhelming goodwill of these ladies. And I kept up with them. Now, the thing is, this was probably 18 months because it was a year we were doing that stuff. Then I moved out the hood to the West End, to the East Point. And I had my own house, and this continued for quite a bit. I got the job at Rent-A-Crate. I was working at Panel Systems, and they were graduating. This is the thing. I mean, these girls literally grew up before my eyes. I even know the Baltimore princess. She became a doctor. I kept up with her for a while. I kept up with all of them for a while, and it just faded away in time. But those were some fond memories. Because I was having normal, fun, consistent relationships in the hood. And I remember to this day, the day that she came bouncing down those steps and over to the bus stop. I mean, And the openness and the willingness and the acceptance, because there was no jealousy, which I would later start to run into with older women. And, you know, many of you may judge me because it's like 17, 18. I think the Jewish princess, she was 18, 19. She went on to Morehouse Medical School. We were still hanging out even when she was in medical school to a degree. And then she met this guy who was becoming a doctor, and they hooked up, and I think they got married because, you know, she was seeking her own level. She was just, she had this model that her parents had put together. He was a doctor, her mom was a doctor. So she knew how that worked, and she knew how to handle that. So that was cool, and I was very happy for her. But Lori, you know, she became a fashion designer. She had her own line of clothes and stuff, and she was doing very well. And then Denise, I think Denise became a school teacher. The way that this set up was just so weird because I was in this space of transformation. I was transforming from the old Cameron to this new Cameron because I saw a lot of my older value system. It didn't really serve me in this new paradigm. You know, you work hard, because this was before I got laid off at PowerTel. And, you know, and I was just confronting so many things, because typically the older me would have had conflicts with messing with girls so young. Because, I mean, I was literally old enough to be their daddy. I was daddy in many ways. And I look back at that, and this set the template for the Craigslist protocols in the future, because I had done this already. It had worked out very well without no negative consequences. So I was very open to it, because a lot of those girls, they were like 18, 19, 20. I remember this one chick, I was hitting it, and she said,
"You like hitting this young white pussy."
I was like, oh my, that put an extra inch on things. But anyway, this is the story of that Spelman chick and how it went off. This is a happy story time. This is a great story time, because I had friends. I had people to hang around with that were not hood people. It was a beautiful thing, because, you know, at one point when I was messing with them, I was working at the Gallup organization, and many of those kids thought I was their age, because the thing is, I never looked my age. So when I was 32, I looked like I was 20 something. So this was one of the reasons I was able to pull this off. And I had my little workout routine where I do my push-ups and knee bends and stuff. So I was in really good shape. I was about 15 pounds less than I am now. And I was, you know, like 220, 230 something. Those were the days, man. Those were the days. So if you like this story time and you want to hear more, be sure to subscribe, hit the bell. And if you want to avoid being in the hood, go below and grab some of these courses. I would recommend money management, so you know how to handle the money you have already. And then ask for the sales to get your money life going on, so you will never have these hood stories. Because that was a bright spot in the hood, but most of my time in the hood wasn't that good.